SAAHJ will award its first ever Corazón de Oro. The award was created to honor the accomplishments of an extraordinary individual, group, or institution whose work has been nationally recognized for excellence in their own fields and whose example serves as an inspiration to others. It can be awarded to those who have helped bring attention to the significant contributions of United States Latinos to the nation's arts and culture, education, philanthropy, and other fields. It is also awarded to those whose extraordinary contributions show a commitment to telling the stories of the Latino population of Texas and the United States. To make that presentation, please join me in welcoming to the stage Henry Muñoz.
I am so glad that the real Henry already spoke so that you wouldn't have us confused. It is an honor and a little bit nerve-wracking, quite honestly, to present this historic award to my friend Robert Rodriguez. I'm not necessarily the first person that you think about putting in a room full of San Antonio journalists, but I am a person who recognizes a room full of inspiring stories and who is constantly looking to the future and what this organization has done to create the next generation of leadership is absolutely incredible and inspiring, like the story I'm going to tell you. Robert Rodriguez grew up in the neighborhood that I live in, not so very far from here in San Antonio, in a big family. I mean, they were a big family. 9 kids. You saw them every single place. You saw them at church, you saw them at the grocery store, and you saw this one kid who was handsome but a little geeky, walking around with a camera, with an old VCR. And that spirit of creativity and innovation and passion led him to be accepted to film school at the University of Texas in Austin. And even then, he had a way of getting his films financed. Even then, $7,000 bought a product that I think was intended to just be a low-budget Spanish language kind of straight-to-video movie, but it was called El Mariachi. And the film was so good that instead of going straight to video, it ended up winning the audience prize at Sundance. And that led to Desperado and the careers of Salma Hayek and Antonio Banderas and Sin City. And his career touched George Clooney and Lady Gaga and Sofia Vergara and Jessica Alba and Machete himself, Danny Trejo. And I think most people would agree that Robert is one of the few Latinos who has actually conquered Hollywood. The wonderful thing about that is that he never left us behind. That same spirit of family he carries with him in everything that he does, whether it's his real family or the family that he creates through the creative community that he's created. So that he's a pioneer in digital media. George Lucas and Steven Spielberg recognize that. He works within Hollywood, but he lives and creates jobs in the state of Texas. Everything that you've just heard me say, many people know. But what you may not know is that he is an incredible designer, a wonderful visual artist, a musician, a powerful spokesperson for the Latino community, a pretty good cook. He's a pretty good cook. And I have watched him over the course of the last several years come into his own in terms of the power and influence that he can use to help lead the way for all of us. I have watched him sit across a table and say to the President of the United States, "With all due respect, sir, this is what needs to happen." And because of his ability to speak truth to power, there are at least 500,000 young people who dream who are better off because of you, Robert. And his legacy is just beginning. That network, El Rey, it's not a Spanish language network. It's a network that is going to change the way that our country views mainstream media. It will change the way that the United States of America looks at our imprint on the popular culture of the United States. So I am very pleased to ask you to watch this film, to view the accomplishments of somebody who is kind of a king, except his crown is a black hat. And his heart may be gold, but it's as big as the state of Texas. Robert Rodriguez.
When filmmakers get together, they all talk of one other filmmaker, the one who is the filmmaker amongst filmmakers, the one that makes us all feel lazy.
Action.
Hello, I'm Robert Rodriguez. I started my film career about 20 years ago with a movie called El Mariachi that I financed by selling my body to science.
And it was that movie that inspired me to become a filmmaker. So much so that one summer when we were going to visit my grandparents in Mexico, I had actually asked my parents if we could drive through Del Rio into Acuña to see if we could locate the set. Robert was the first person that looked like me that I saw in the industry. He showed me that it was possible to go out and to become a filmmaker, and he allowed me to believe that we can go out and achieve our childhood dreams if we put in the work.
When you want to do anything, you got to reduce your I need list to very little. Because if you start going, well, I want to do this, but I need first a crew, I need a budget, I need set. I mean, the longer that list gets, the further away you're going to accomplish that.
Right.
So you got to shrink that down to I need nothing.
He taught me the strength and courage to go out and be able to achieve any goal that I had set. And with that, I set a goal to produce my first feature film before I was 30 years old.
When you've got that moment of pure fear, that's when you know you're going in the right direction.
Give it up, man, for an absolute legend. Without this guy, a lot of us wouldn't be filmmaking at all. This man is a shooter. He breathes and lives film. You cut him film.
Robert has been a leader, a mentor, and has inspired my generation of filmmakers.
You have your own network. You, Oprah, Diddy, end of list.
Going to be exciting, visceral, addictive entertainment, but with an eye towards keeping that diversity, having the face of a network more resemble the face of the country. This is the People's Network. I want you all to join.
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome and congratulate San Antonio's own Robert Rodriguez.
The best tequila that I've never drank, or it's an amazing award. Thank you so much for this. This is an incredible piece of art. Wow, this is really wonderful to come back here home for Corazón de Oro Award. I had to think about what this meant, and it has a lot of significance. And it's going to be hard not to be emotional. First, Henry Cisneros, you were mayor when I was a kid. You inspired me. John Quiñones, you always inspired me. And y'all gave those great speeches and got me all emotional before I even get up here. So thank you for that. Now I get to cry like a baby in front of my children. Of course, my dad's over there crying already. As soon as I said hello, he was crying, so I can't look over there. But I have some personal stories to tell them. I might skip the personal one and leave it for the end because it'll make me too emotional. But I do remember starting off as a filmmaker. It was amazing. I did make El Mariachi for the straight-to-video market, and then out of my, you know, here in San Antonio, I came up with a lot of these ideas, my brothers and sisters. There was actually 10. You couldn't even count all of them. There were so many. It was actually 10 of us, but that made a great, you know, cast and crew for me in my movies and at home. So I made a bunch of little home movies with them that would go and win awards, and they were like precursors to Spy Kids. I made all those here in San Antonio before I went to UT. When I went to UT, I made this movie, El Mariachi, for the straight-to-video Spanish, you know, video market. And I wanted to do all the jobs myself because I thought I had to learn. I learned from a great mentor, a teacher here, told me that if you're creative and you become technical, you'll be unstoppable. So I thought, wow, so if I go learn how to actually make a movie all by myself, I'll always be able to just go make a dream happen and not have to need a big budget or anything. So El Mariachi was actually just a test film. But the test kind of started winning festivals and got released theatrically. And what happened next is when I went to go follow it up, I thought, well, let me do another one kind of like that called Desperado. And I was shocked to find there was just no Latinos working in Hollywood. I mean, there were just none. So I realized I had to create my own star system because anything I was going to write was going to have an Hispanic in it because you write in your own image. And if you write, you know, fade in, Hispanic American character walks into a tent, you're like, well, who's going to play this? Studio will cast somebody who's not even Hispanic because they'll have more of a name. So we have to, there's a lot of work to be done. So I had to create my own star system. I found Salma in Mexico. I brought Antonio from Spain. Danny Trejo, I just put him in every movie till he became a star. I brought back Cheech Marin. He hadn't done anything in a while. Put him in. So Desperado had this star-studded cast because it's all about precedent. When I go to make my next movie, they could then say, oh, that was the actor from Desperado. Okay, I guess you can use them. They've been in a movie now. It broke through. It's all about precedent. So then I would just take the same group of actors from movie to movie, from Dust Till Dawn to Spy Kids to Sin City, and you ended up changing the landscape of Hollywood. About 10 years after that, after Desperado, I did Sin City, and to show you how much it changed in 10 years. Benicio del Toro is in it, Rosario Dawson, Jessica Alba, Alexis Bledel, and none of them are playing Latino. It was a real groundbreaking that took place after 10 years. But there was still, you know, a lot of work to be done. I remember when I did Spy Kids, it was very new. I mean, the studio was like, I don't understand. Why are you making them Hispanic? Why are you making the family Hispanic? Why don't you just make them American? That would just confuse people. And, well, they are American. They're Hispanic American. And it's not going to be in Spanish. I mean, it's going to, I think, it'll play to everybody. It had never been done before. And they go, we don't understand. Why don't you just make it, why don't you just make them American? And they weren't being malicious or anything. It was an honest question. This shows you how groundbreaking even a movie as Spy Kids was. And I finally came up with the answers, and it was, you know what, you don't have to be British to watch James Bond. And they said, oh, okay. They just wanted to know why. Why I was pushing it so hard. But it was for personal reasons. I said, it's based on my family. I'm Hispanic, so it's a Hispanic family. My uncle was named Gregorio. My uncle was a special agent in the FBI. He brought down 2 top 10 criminals. I'm very proud of him. I want to do a movie character about him. Antonio's going to play him. My siblings are the stars, so it has to be Hispanic. But unless you're the storyteller making those scripts and telling the stories, then you can cast the actors. It was never going to change. And that changes a lot. And when the opportunity came to own a television network where you could break through and have the country reflected in your television set. That's something I had never seen. And my sister, Angela, was actually the first person to try to become an actor in Hollywood. She studied acting. She was 4 years older than me. She moved to New York, and she hadn't changed her name. She sent back bad news to my father, saying, I can't get work as a Rodriguez, so I'm changing my name to Lanza, because you like Mario Lanza, so this is kind of okay, all right? And I remember being really upset by that. Not upset with my sister, just upset about an industry where you would be denied work because of your name. And I was very determined from that day forward to change that. I was not going to change my name. I hope you're not getting tears all over your dessert. If you are, I'm sorry. I was not going to change my name. I was going to actually very determined to make that name mean something, to inspire everyone else who was at Rodriguez to go, I can be there. And it was a lot of work. So like I said, it wasn't just a matter of going and picketing and telling Hollywood to put more actors in movies. There were no roles for them. We needed to start from completely from the ground up. That's why the El Rey Network is, we're building it from the ground up to where we're really moving the needle. I mean, if you look at the representation in this country, it's really sad on television. Of Hispanics are 17-18% of the country. On television, on prime time, we're under 5%. And if you're in front of and we're behind the camera is 2%. On the El Rey Network, we move the needle to 60%, front of and behind the camera. And actually, it's almost flipped completely the other way. There was one actor that I was a fan of. I said, I'm going to give you a job. And the actor asked, you're going to put me in this movie? Now's the time to decide. Should I change my name? My name's Hernandez. Should I change it? And I go, I'm actually not going to hire you if you change your name. It's reversed now. You will not get work if you change your name. Because we need you. I mean, how many Hernandezes are there in this world? Think about it. Now, how many can you name, top of your head, name me two that are in the popular culture that you can name? Or actors or filmmakers or name them. No. So we need to have the more Hernandez, if you go as a Hernandez, you become famous. Kind of a little joke, of course. But if you go and you become famous, it's going to tell all the other Hernandezes they could be there too, and the Vasquez and the Sanchez. Quiñones, who was always, Cisneros, was very inspiring. We just need more of that. We need to move that needle. It still has a long way to go. And it's all out there. The funniest thing is that Hollywood is all about remaking old stuff and rebooting things. There's no more new stories. There are so many stories they've never heard that are very universal. The funny irony is that those who feel they can't get in actually are the ones that have all the gold. They got all the gold. The stories they have, the gold that's in their pockets around them, in their communities, in their culture, the gold in their heart. Corazones, the oro that you all have inside you. That's the future. I brought my son, two of my boys. I want my 17-year-old son just to stand up, Maximiliano, just for a second. I was exactly your age. And I agree with what Quiñones said about, the, you know, inspire the youth. That's why I brought my son, actually, because I was exactly your age when my sister changed her name and I decided, that's wrong. There's something wrong about that. Not wrong with her, but wrong with them. If there's a system that does not work, you have to go in, you have to change the system. If it's just broken and obsolete, you make your own system. And that's the way you do it. So, inspire your children. They are the future. Thank you for this. You all have a great responsibility ahead of you, but imagine all that we can do together. I mean, the story I told you about how far I moved the needle, that's one person. Imagine this network of people that we've created now in the business and how much we can do together for the good of the people, because it's huge. It's one of the reasons why I got into the network. I was so excited when I got this network. I went back, just to show you what the challenge is, I went back to a friend of mine. He's a very, you know, upstanding citizen in Austin. He's a famous chef. He's very well known there. And I told him, all excited, I got a network. So let's create that restaurant we were talking about. Because we can film it and put a show on the network. Because they need programming on the network. We can make it famous on the network. And he was like, suddenly he went from being this excited guy to this guy with a his head starts going down like that. That Hispanic head tilt that you see sometimes. And he goes, no, I don't really have good ideas. And I was like, what are you talking about? Oh, just go up.
It's an Amber Alert, everybody. It's an Amber Alert. It's your cell phone's going off.
Well, if you can hear me, does that sound better? Is that right? Yeah, my friend, he had his head down and he said, oh, I don't know, I don't have good ideas. How can you say that? How can you say you don't have good ideas? Let me be the judge if it's a good idea. Now you just give me some ideas. He goes, well, I'm embarrassed. You know, it's I speak Spanish pretty good, but I'm illiterate in Spanish. I don't read it or write it. Oh, no. The network's in English. I thought he would be excited by that. And instead, he gave me an even more distasteful look. He said, what, you mean bocho? And I was like, wow. Look what you just called yourself. You just called yourself a bocho. You have a negative view of yourself. Because, you know, when you're called bocho, you don't really have anything to come back with. Because you're like, yeah, I guess I am. You know, Mexican, a more proud person you can't meet, you know. But when they meet a pocho, they go, you're a pocho, and you got nothing to come back with. Never did. And so he goes, wow, I never thought of it. I struggle with that every day. Every day you struggle with that. You feel less than because you don't speak the language. And there's so many like you. That's the generation that's out there now. What if there was a network where you could look at it and turn it on? You go, that's me. That's who I am in this country. Not only that, I can show it to all my friends who aren't Latino, and they look at it, and it's just cool. That's where we need to take it now, is to unify, because this is what I told the president. Hey, look, we're 1 in 6 in this country is Hispanic. Even Hispanics are surprised there's that many. We're like, where is everybody? Well, if they all got their head down like my friend, where they don't want to get called out for being Hispanic, no matter how much they've accomplished, that's a problem. It's a problem when people have a limited view of what they can achieve, no matter how much they have achieved, because they just don't see themselves reflected in the media. That's how powerful the media is. That's what you're wielding. It's that powerful that if you look at it and you see someone like my friend who becomes popular and has his own show, and then you go, that's me, I'm like that. Oh, it's okay to be like that. You go from being a number that no one understands to being a people, and that's what we need to do. We need to become a people. We're going to be 1 in 3 by 2050, and we can't have a society that feels like that about themselves because they're afraid they're going to be called out for being Hispanic because they haven't taken that Berlitz course yet and they don't know how to speak it. It's not important. It's about what's in here. It's not about how you say it, but what you say. So there's a lot of work still to be done. And if you're 17 and you're looking and you got ideas, know that those ideas can trigger your mission for the rest of your life. This is a very important time. Inspire your youth. Thank you for this. We got a long way to go. I hope you ride with me in El Rey. And thank you for San Antonio for always being there for me.
Well, that was an inspiring evening, and I appreciate you allowing me to be part of it. Thank you very much, and thank you to the San Antonio Association of Hispanic Journalists. Thanks to all of you. I'm sorry? Okay. Too late. Okay. And thanks to all of you for being here, too, and for supporting the mission of fostering diversity in new generations of media professionals. Good night. Enjoy the rest of your evening. And muy buenas noches.